No, thank you for the many years of great music. How about that?
Okay. Okay, well, that's very kind. Hopefully, a couple more years left in me. But hey, I'm just trying to check out your T-shirt, Park City Song.
Park City Song Summit. It was this music festival in Park City, Utah, that I went to a couple of weeks ago, that was focused on singer-songwriters and producers and the like. You'd be a good fit for it, but hey, we're not here to talk about Park City. We're here to talk about your new album. How long did it take to actually make this album?
Because I'm in a constant state I'm in a constant state of creativity.
As an artist.
it sounds a bit highfalutin. But probably 18 months. And but in that time, I would have been working on my other project as well. Sure. And also I still as a songwriter for hire, which is what I spent many years, I still pitch songs to you know, like one other artist. So I do that too, you know, I get an idea and I go like, or maybe that would be good for Brian. I'll send that to him and yeah. Then get a very terse two-word response and then have another go. So, but 18 months for this album. So actually, some of the songs are songs from, you know, a few of them are songs from my past. I mean, the last decade that I was like, that's a really cool song. Why did nobody ever do that? I can, because I can produce, I can go like, well, if I imagine that as in the style of, say, Jeff Lynne, mm-hmm. then would it work in that like that? So then hopefully it keeps everything fresh. Everything was recorded in the last 18 months, so it's drips and drabs.
It's an interesting career path that you have, because there's a lot of people doing what you do. If you know, yes, you are your own person, but somebody like Dan Wilson from Semisonic, the way that he had his band on the major label thing, then he became kind of a solo artist writing and producing for other artists. And when he writes a song, he goes, I don't know, is this for my solo album or is this for a global mega hit? That kind of a thing.
Oh, yeah. Shall I put it on my album that will sell 10,000 copies if I'm lucky? Or should I give it to this artist who will sell 25 million? That's, yeah. Yeah, I actually worked with Dan 20-odd years ago. When he was in that start of that phase, when I think Semisonic were kind of had their moment. What great tunes they had too!
Oh yeah,
Chemistry. What a brilliant song!
That is my favorite of the Semisonic albums. It wasn't a commercial success here. I know it got some 5-star reviews in the UK, but I always thought that the Chemistry album was the best album that he'd ever worked on. And unfortunately, that's not the case for most.
That happens, doesn't it? When you like music and everybody goes, you go, this is amazing, and everybody goes, no, that's amazing, really? And you look on as some, yeah. And I, his disclosure, I don't know the album. I only ever listen to singles. I'd like to think I'm relatively shallow in that respect. But at least I can say that now that I don't care that artists are going to be upset that I produce tracks for them and then I don't listen to their other songs, because you know
I've actually heard that, if you don't mind me like name dropping. So a friend of mine was super Bang. Close with Adam Schlesinger, and
yes.
Adam Schlesinger,
what a genius!
What a genius he was. When he started out co-writing for other artists, he was trying to, you know, also produce some of the albums too. And he was going like, this one didn't work out. But he eventually stole the advice of Rick Ocasek, who was only trying to produce two songs on the album or co-write two songs on the album. He wasn't trying to be on the whole project, just the ones that he thought that would be the singles.
Yes.
When did you kind of realize that strategy to it all? Because if I look at the Natalie Imbruglia album, I think you had like 7 cuts on there.
Yeah. Well, you know, I was very lucky when I was 18. My first boss, I left school and went to work for a music impresario called Mickey Most, who in his day was like Simon Cowell, or he was one of those people that picked the songs. This is where he was different from Simon Cowell. He could pick a hit song in any style, not just pop, and he would produce it. He would own the studios. He would own the publishing of the songwriters.
Yes, he would.
He would release it on his record label. I think they now call it 360.
Yes.
And all he was really interested in was, because he worked so fast, he would really care about the singles. And a single would maybe spend 2 days on that. The album, the other 10 cuts, 5 days. Bang, 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 bang. It was business. And it was so refreshing because ultimately, usually what happened was the singles got on the radio, would get in the top 20. And so I did look at that, and I took a lot of advice from him. He would go, if you don't, you know, he was all about the songs. So oftentimes in my early career as a producer, they would... record company, you'd send a song and you go, yeah, I'd love to produce that. And I would. And then they'd have relative success. And then they go, here's the next single. And I go, no, I don't like that. I don't like that song. And they'd be, what do you mean? You're a producer. And I was going, I don't get the song. You know, I don't feel like I can turn that into a hit. It doesn't sound like a hit to me. So there would be, but that's what I had learned from my boss. Albeit he, you know, maybe I was obviously quite precocious, and I was going, well, I think my skills at A&R are better than than the record companies. But at least it was, you know, I look back and go, well, that was honest. You know, why pick up a check and try and produce? You're only going to destroy your reputation, because if they want a hit. And I thought about this lately. Nobody talks about flops, you know. The only people are only interested in the hits. Mm-hmm. They don't go like, "Well, how did you produce that B-side?" You know, it's
5% of the music listeners arguably do, but sometimes the 5% doesn't add up to a gold record,
or a career. And at the end of the day, you know, it's really hard to make a living in the music business. So.
Yeah.
You got to keep maybe whilst we love music, you've also got to keep one eye on the fact that, or I used to, you know, what's happening in the charts, what's on the radio, what can I take from that hit record, what can I learn from that, blah blah blah.
So when you land a song on an album, some artists, it's that their publisher pitched it. Other cases, they were in the room and actually wrote it. Other times, like Torn, it was written 4 or 5 years before that kind of situation. Has it been a mix of that in your career?
Yeah, I think that's fair to say, Darren. The best route to get, you know, in business terms, for is if you're in the room with the artist and write the song. The issue with that for me is often. You end up with a song that you go kind of go like, yeah, okay, you know, it's quite good, but it gets on the album because the artist manager has signed the artist to a publishing deal. They now have to commit and have so many songs recorded. This is where the music business starts becoming kind of, if you peel back, well, you know about this. If you peel back the layer and you go, well, is that a good idea, just putting the not so good songs on the album, as long as they're if you don't get the single, you know, but that route of writing with the artist, that's a very good way to get on record. And if you're lucky enough to be able to write with the artists, sometimes, like in the case of Torn, my publisher, Mark Fox, who used to be in the band Haircut 100, he said, I had a meeting with him and Natalie, and he said, you absolutely should do this song. So it was great advice. He said, this is going to change your career. And it's a sort of like, phrase you sort of hear bandied around, you know, kids, I'm going to make you big stars. You know, it was kind of the English way of saying that. But that happens less and less frequently where the publisher places the song. And a lot of times, in my case, my manager, who I've been with for Bill Stonebridge, who I've been with for years and years, he knows the A&R, and so he would go and take a meeting. He's very, very subtle, and he would say things like, I told so-and-so at Warner Brothers, I said, Sony really want to cut this song, but I'll let you hear it. And the Warner Brothers A&R person would be like, oh, Sony going to cut it. It is a good song. Yeah. I want it. I guarantee I'm going to. But can you guarantee it's going to be on the? I guarantee it's going to be on the album. Thank you very much. So that's when it helps as a creative, which I am, to have a business person alongside you who can do those, who can. You know, help you on your path to glory, because they understand how a business works. You understand how a record's made, So those routes that you mentioned—that's all valid ways of getting on a record. And if you're lucky, and it's really difficult to get on an album. All it was when I used to chase those things, because they record 120 songs. It's just. I think it's insane. You know, it is like throwing mud at a wall and just hoping something sticks. But I can say that now because I'm out of that process. And when you're in it, you become very competitive, and because all your contemporaries, you go, oh, damn, so-and-so, they got two songs on the album, and they got the sing. The moment someone has a hit, say there's 10 writers for an album, or co-writers, and if one of them, in the time of making the album, has a hit, their song will be the first single. Record companies just, they gravitate, if the brand is strong. And I was successful because of that, too. After Torn, my manager would call me up and say, oh, you know that old song? And you go, yeah, the one that nobody likes. Yeah, so-and-so is cutting it. And you go, it's because I've just been lucky enough to be gifted this massive hit record. And now everybody is looking at the songs going, yeah, you know, actually, this is quite good. You know,
they're taking your leftovers but making them seem like they were the hits the whole time, which when you can get that passive income mailbox money, you take it. But
thank you very much. I will.
One thing I'm super curious about is the more you speak with iconic songwriters and producers, the more you find out that the hits in the States and the UK were not the hits in Asia and Europe, and that there might have been specific albums or singles made for Asia or other countries or territories. Did you have any cases where there were huge albums that you wrote on or produced in other countries that we've never heard of here in the States?
Yes. 10 years ago, my biggest, it was a really, really good period. There's a UK singer called Pixie Lott, female singer, pop soul, nice kind of soul. Just a joy to just one of the most positive, joyful people to work with, and has the chops too. Has the singing chops, and it was a massive hit here. The album sold like almost a million, which was back then. And she had a big American manager. I mean, a big American manager. And Universal going to release it there. And then next album, Universal are going to release. They're going to make a package, and then they're going to push it. Third album, you go, forget it. So the songs I'm very proud of. We had two number ones, but in the UK, never heard of in the US. Probably never heard of in Japan or Korea or the rest. Might have been a territory in Europe that was picked. It got picked up on, but. It the records, you know, we made hit records, and for whatever reason, it wasn't. And I think they would have been hits in America, but it's the politics of between the record companies, even if they're all, it's Universal in the UK or Universal in the US, they're very competitive with each other.
Yeah.
And they're going, well, we didn't A&R this record. I'm not going to advance my career by releasing your record. That's why Torn is such an outlier, because here's a little insight into music business. As I understand it, we made the album. Well, we were making the album. Natalie was on RCA, which was part of...
Now it's Sony BMG, but originally it wasn't?
Yes, it was part of BMG. Yeah. Back then, a different BMG, along with Arista, Ariola, lots of other labels. And her record was played to all the A&R staff in America from these different labels. Pass, 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 pass. Nobody wanted it. Torn came out in London, started just skyrocketing. Suddenly, the label, one of the labels, now the A&R guy who had passed on it, wanted it put on his label and have his name as A&R executive.
Ah. Right. He was the genius the whole time.
And well, I mean, you know, you sort of understand. It's a ruthless. You know, you've got to attach yourself to success, and or one way or another. There's a famous, what's the Rudyard Kipling quote? Success has 1,000 fathers, and defeat is an orphan. Like nobody wants to be. Did you? I thought you were involved with that record. No, not me. If you have a hit, everyone's like, yeah, I knew that. I put those guys in the room. Yeah, did you? Well, I knew the guy that put them in the room. So this is sounding very bitter. I don't. I'm cynical. But
no, I love it. And let's bring it back to you and the fact that you have a great new record. When you have to make small talk with people, which, you know, inevitably it happens. You're waiting in a line. You're on an airplane. Whatever it is.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
You, Phil, are pretty hard to define, because a lot of people would go, yeah, I played in The Cure as their calling card the rest of their life. But being a sideman is one thing you do. You have this new album, you're a producer, you're a mixer, you're a writer for other artists. When someone goes, what do you do for a living? Do you have your elevator pitch or your like thing
yeah.
you say?
Well, because I always wanted to be a songwriter. And that's the thing I love doing most. I've picked up these other skills along the way. So I say, I'm a songwriter. And then inevitably, they say, well, what's your biggest song? And you know what? Even though it was 25 years ago since Torn was a smash, and it was an international smash.
Yes.
Now, of course, there are kids that go, that might ask, go, no, never heard of it. Never heard of it. And of course, anyone that's my, maybe my kids' generation, my generation or older, they're listening, they might be listening to middle of the road radio, and they go, oh, yeah, of course, Torn, you're kidding. You know, and I always say, yeah, I wrote it with Scott Cutler and Anne Previn, and, you know, I always like to, because I didn't write that, I wrote it with two other great writers, so, but I did produce it. So, in short, that's my go-to, because there were so many members of The Cure. If you say they were in I was in The Cure, somebody might go, oh, I saw The Cure in Poland in 94. Okay, I was in The Cure for 18 months, you know. I made a couple of good records with them. That's more likely where I would go to. But Torn... If nobody knows Torn, I'm lost, you know, like I'm a zero.
You don't go Bryan Adams as the second one?
You're right. Everybody does know Bryan, but I never wrote a hit for Bryan. I've written songs, you know, lots of songs with Bryan, and probably 6 or 7 have made his albums. But and another 20 have been covered by other artists.
Keep in mind with Bryan Adams, we love that Get Up album in this household. We played a song from Get Up at our wedding. So to us, Bryan Adams is still at top of his game. So the fact that you worked with Bryan Adams in the last 10 years is a great thing.
Yeah. You know, I was, this is one of the great stories for me, for my career. When Torn happened, I was getting calls, you know, you have this really hot record and everybody's calling up. Now, one of the first people I ever met in the music business, he was actually like a hanger-on of a rock and roll band. But his name was David Rose, or his name still is David Rose. He eventually ended up being Bryan Adams' A&R man, you know, and he called me up and he said, "Do you want to work with Bryan?" And I was like, that was the one call that I was like, absolutely. And then we got together and wrote a couple of songs quite fast. And he's great. He's just the best singer. Yeah. And his chops are amazing, and he gets better. I was lucky enough to be in the band for a spell, which was and I had one song on the Get Up album, which is
That song, It's Only Rock and Roll or something like
Oh, we wrote that because it's like a three chord tune, and we kept rewriting it. That's Rock and Roll. There you go. Right. Yeah. And that because I'm the same age as him, and I think we had a lot in common back then. But mainly, I loved his voice.
Yeah.
And he liked the thing that I did, you know, with producing, and I like guitars. And so, I miss those days. I was in the band for 18 months and just was loving it. And then the Spanish Archer, as they call it here, Elbow, I was, I was let go. So, but these things happen, Darren.
But those credits just are fantastic. And the Love Cats bass line from The Cure, everyone asks you about that. But what I was curious about, which I couldn't figure out through research, was did you have free reign to come up with the tone and the bass line itself? Or did they go, the song goes like this and here you go?
So I was in The Cure at the time, and at sound check, Robert had a cassette of the sketch of the idea, and he had the opening bass line. The famous, just in case. He had that. And so Andy Anderson, the late Andy Anderson, and I seem to remember we'd kind of routine it in soundcheck. We get, and Andy had this little like jazz shuffle feel, great player, really, really solid. And we were also young, and we went on this promotional tour to America, played some concerts. One moment we're in San Francisco, and the next moment we're in Paris, in a studio in Paris. And now, we did that song like piecemeal. I think Andy did the drum track, very simple but super solid, and Robert played a kind of fours feel on the piano. Mm-hmm. I guess there must have been a guide vocal. So I had that bass line, the starter point, and then kind of made up my own, just followed that through the changes. So it's Robert's idea, and it's a great idea, but I do get a lot of credit for that. But it was his original bass line, and then I expounded on it. And when I listen to it, I just think I did it. I'm really proud of that, because even jazz bass players, this happened to me a few months ago, this proper double bass player, like crazy good. I was chatting with him, and he leaned his bass over to chat to me whilst he was playing the tune that he was playing, to say like, oh, how much he loved Love Cats. And I was like, doesn't it sound like an kind of, not an idiot, but like a first timer? And he's like, no, it sounds great. So, yeah. And it's brought me infamy as well, I suppose.
You know, it goes on that list as somebody who's a bass player, but an amateur bass player, where one of my other favorite bands is New Order, and the bass lines are not technically very good when Peter Hook is doing that, but it's the hook of the song. And it's the rare case where Love Cats, the bass is arguably the hook of the song.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, there's lots of great elements. It's a great production, although I say so myself. But with Peter Hook, usually the bass is actually being played by a bass synth. He's playing like a cello line, a really catchy one. You know, I think that's a really important element, of course, of New Order, was that his bass line as a counterpoint to the melody, adding a kind of sound that no one had heard before. I never met him, but who doesn't love his swagger as well, playing it below his knees. It's like, it keeps you honest, doesn't it? If you play like that, you can't. But that's one play. What a style. Yeah. I wish looking back when I was a teenager, I had a style, and, you know, there was like slapping where people would use their thumb, with the great Larry Graham would create like a drum beat by thumbing the bass note and then plucking with his finger the top note. So it gave it like a kick and a snare sound. Boom, 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 bang, boom, boom. And in my punk days, I used to do the reverse of that. I actually played with the back of my thumb, like didn't use a pick, didn't use my fingers, didn't slap. I slapped with the other way around with my thumb. And for a punk band, it was a good sound because it was just kind of messy and we weren't a great punk band either. But I gave that style up, and I look back and go, maybe I've never seen anybody else do that. So there's put that down as one of my regrets as a bass player is not keeping... Right now, they'd say, yeah, Peter Hook, he did that thing. Larry Graham, he did slapping. Jaco did the fretless bass. And Phil did that rock and roll bass, the thumb the wrong way around thing.
But you never succumbed to pick-based bass playing.
No, I did. I am principally a pick bass player. I guess because I became studio person, that it's always I do the bass. I love playing the bass, but when I add the bass, I do it based. It's around what the song needs, and like what frequency do you need to be at. So I sometimes play my fingers, sometimes I play with my thumb with a felt under the strings. But with Brian and The Cure, it was a lot of picking. It was pick. It was heavy. It's rock and roll.
Like your song with Brian Adams.
Yeah. That's rock and roll.
So my last question for you, being respectful of your time here, because it's been an honor and a pleasure.
No, Darren, please, you know, I've messed you about, so here we are. You can have as much time as you probably got to get onto something else anyway, but
maybe
that's nice
of you. Maybe I don't, but some people, when they finish a big project like an album, they go, so I've already started working on my next album. Other people go, oh, I'm not doing another one of those.
Yeah.
Which camp are you in?
I'm in the first camp. I don't stop. Music is mystery. I'm learning every day. I don't stop. Thankfully, I don't stop getting ideas for songs. In fact, I had one today, and I'm going to share it with you.
Okay.
I haven't even Googled the title to see. And it's like a naff. It's a naff idea. Okay, instead of One Night Stand, it's One Night Stan. Like, there's a guy called One Night Stan who. So that was today's idea. I can tell by your reaction that you're disappointed, and I don't blame you.
No, but, I'm not disappointed. I'm just only on my first cup of coffee. I wake up. We're before noon here, local time. My brain starts operating really well around 3 or 4 p.m.
Okay.
I'd say with Stan, you see the young people, refer to like borderline stalker people here as stans because of that Eminem song, Stan.
And the Eminem tune, yeah.
So is Phil thinking that the guy's a stalker?
Yeah.
Like he's a one-night stalker,
Yeah. Well, you've opened up a world of possibility. And I can tell I'm going to be hearing from your publisher quite soon as well.
Well, I mean,
apparently Darren tells me.
Yeah, change a word, get a third.
There's nothing wrong with that. I have been blessed with people changing a word and recording a song. So, one night stand. We'll see.
We see that in some form. But long story short, you know, you're clearly doing music because you want to at this point in time. It's more passion-based than out of necessity. So at this point in time, how often are you in writing sessions?
I don't write with anybody else now. I used to Monday to Friday with my good friend David Monday. For 10 years, we work in, because we were sort of hot, you know, post-torn. And so we made hay while the sun shone. But now I don't get the call anymore, which is unsurprising. You know, you got to keep getting, having hits. And I think I reached a point in my life where I was upset. I had a hard time. And then I discovered that if I started making my own music, which I hadn't done basically since I was 17 or 18, that it made me happy. And luckily enough, because of the body of, you know, because of the songs that I earn royalties on, I was able to do that. And I'm one in 10,000 people in the music business who can say, and I'm very grateful for that, but I worked really, really hard. And then I just went, you know what, I'm going to make records based on my love of Todd Rundgren, other 70s records. I want to make a record with a rock and roll band and an orchestra. So that's the new album, Now That I Have Your Attention. And thankfully, as you know, Andrew Campbell, head of Low Jinx.
I didn't realize you were a mutual friend of Andrew. There you go.
No, Andrew is the record company for me. I'm on the label that Fountains of Wayne were once on. So,
and Butch Walker. And you see, sometimes people don't get to know the people whose record company, who's running the record company. They just go, let the manager deal with it, and I'm on my own.
It is. Andrew has been fantastic. Via a mutual friend, introduced me to Andrew, and I played my Astral Drive record, the first one, to Andrew, more or less to say, do you know anybody? I think this is really good. And Andrew said, yeah, I'll release it. And it was so refreshing, because I was just presuming he'd go, well, maybe speak to Johnny at Big Bang Records. He might like that sort of thing. But so our relationship started then. And then he released last year's Astral Drive Orange album. And then this year's released my solo album, which all the other records are solo albums, but this is a very different, more of a fun sound, more of a tongue-in-cheek sound, more of a rock and roll sound maybe too. And Andrew's kind of, for some reason, he's like cheerleads. He goes, this is great, do some more. So... And I'm so insecure after 45 years in the music business that I go, really? Okay, I know how to do that. Yeah, so it's a nice, it's a good professional working relationship. So the
lesson that I'm hearing and learning right here now, Andrew himself being a great musician of his own right from the band Farrah, that point forward, is you deal with the commercial mainstream success when you can. But ultimately, it all comes back to the niche people who love it, keeping them close and working with them long term. And then when the mainstream commercial thing happens again, you do that, but you're just going to keep coming back to your people.
Yeah, that's a really nice way of putting it. I hope it stays like that. I would love to have another hit, obviously more than likely with another artist, a younger artist or established artist. The fire burns strong for me to still do that, but it's really great to feel creative and then have the support of a record company person that gets and likes what you do and is amused by it, and also offers, you know, some trenchant advice, like at the right time. I get very overexcited That's like one of the things that's kind of good when you work with other people on sessions. You know, I've always like been enthusiastic. I know what we can do with this. Let's do this. And, you know, play all the stuff and whatnot. And but sometimes that is overbearing, that enthusiasm. And Andrew has a nice kind of leveling quality where he's kind of like, yeah, it keeps my feet on the ground. Otherwise, you know, who knows what could happen next. It might be I might actually write my first symphony or piano concerto, but that is very, very unlikely since I can't read or write music. So,
didn't Scott McCartney.
Well, I think that's, I failed miserably at school at music, you know, failed as into the choir, took lessons, useless, ended up teaching myself, and it's been fantastic. And yeah, so, and I play pretty much every day. I never practice. I just pick up a guitar or sit at the piano or the drums and just go like, oh, this is still fun. This is, you know, why does three chords go so far? You know, yeah, it's
all inspirational that you kind of defied the odds over and over and over again, and then became your own cottage industry and are your own island, and you're not waiting on the calls, and you're just going to do music no matter what. That's what I get.
Yeah, that would be nice, Darren. I would still, just as a side note, I would still love to get the call as bass player for a, you know, mega band.
Megadeth. You want the mega?
No, I think I'm more the. I've definitely got the 5-star touring. I've enjoyed that, and I really don't want to go back to the, playing the toilets of. Of the universe, but needs must. So, well, we'll see.
But hopefully, there's not a song in the pipeline called "Toilets of the Universe." One night stand for now.
But I think we're writing two B sides as we're doing this.
I just have to say thank you for the many years of great music in some form. It's great to see that this is not your last album, and we're going to get some new music in some form, in some genre we don't know yet.
Well, I hope inspiration keeps striking, but I would sincerely love to write another hit song. But watched with the years I have to enjoy. But let's see. Who knows?